Thank you, Ron. It's an honor to be here. I'd say I'm delighted to be here on a Saturday afternoon because that's where it would be if I was still in California, which I left 3 days ago. So I really appreciate you coming out on a Sunday morning and wasting a really great day here. I think we're slated for a horrendous period of time. And I did not come here prepared to do a lecture. I don't want to do a lecture. What I really, this model, which Ron pioneered my first visit here 3 years ago, was to have me have a few slides that I just popped up to stimulate questions and then dialogue that. It's a little bigger audience than we've done before, but do we want to try to do it that way? Because sitting, standing here and talking at you and for an hour and a half or two or whatever is probably an overdose. So let me start by saying, Rod indicated that I spent quite a few decades as a heretic. There are a lot of things that I've been forced to come to understand that are completely different than what I was trained to do as a physician. And each one of those violations of the consensus turn out to be key components of helping people become successful in managing the metabolic damage that's done by eating a very high carbohydrate and sugar and refined diet. So I want to touch on multiple of those heresies, not just so that you know they exist. I want to get to the point where you not only could pass a test to say if Steve Phinney believes X and then Y and Z, but that you maybe realize that there's some credibility to that, to my arguments on each of those components. Because as a healthcare instructor in medical education in the US for 20 years, I learned that you can teach people knowledge that can pass the test, but you don't change their belief structure. And just briefly reciting, here's a paper that shows X. And in tests, unless you can change people's beliefs, you can't change their behaviors. And one of them you already heard about, Dale mentioned that she doesn't exercise, and people, what? And then you heard Sami mention that, Rod mentioned that there are athletes who are very interested in this. So if, you know, A, we don't preach exercise, but B, athletes are coming to us and asking us, how do we do this? I mean, that's a disconnect. How does that work? So let me give you a little bit of a very brief background, which ties into this athletic issue. So just by way of disclosure, I'm previously a professor of medicine. I had three academic appointments. I was kind of itinerant over 20 years at three different institutions. I ended up at the University of California at Davis and spent 12 years there in academic medicine. And in that setting, did what I think is probably some of my better research, but did not succeed academically. I made it to full professor, but I wasn't getting the grants, research support, and the credibility I needed to run a lab and teach young physicians and graduate students adequately and so on. So eventually I gave up on academia. That was 15 years ago. So I guess that qualifies me now as being a recovering academic. I don't know if you have the 12-step program here. I have a 12-step program, and one of them is don't believe every talking head that I see, including me. So I always treat my data with skepticism, because I have proved myself over 30 plus years that some of the things I knew were true 30 years ago turned out to be wrong. And a lot of what I know now is going to turn out to be wrong. Let's say half of it's wrong, I just don't know which half. Most recently, Rod mentioned I'm the author of this book. If you look carefully, and I don't have a picture to project, but the first author is Jeff Volek, RD, PhD. And if Jeff hadn't approached me in 2003 and said, Steve, I read your work, I've done some research, I'm convinced you're right, and it looks to me like you've kind of given up on this, you know, you got to get back into this battle. So my younger, smarter, stronger, more handsome colleague picked me up, dusted me off, and really pulled me back into this endeavor. And that we did some research together starting in 2003 through about 2009 that convinced us that this is not just a short-term fix that'll make some technical things, a person's weight or their biochemistries look better, that this can be a safe and sustainable long-term for life program that will help people who have damaged metabolism recover the health of their metabolism. So Jeff is the first author on this because I consider him, you know, my guide, my leader. He's 25 years younger than I am. But he's also, when I'm gone, he's the person who's leading this field. So just to acknowledge Jeff. So we were convinced after this book was published and people began to say, you know, if that really helps us put the pieces together, we were encouraged to put together a actual program to manage, particularly our primary focus is people with type 2 diabetes, because that's probably one of the most acute health crises that developed and developing nations around the world face. And so we were kind of encouraged by some people who said, we'd like to, you know, if you can put together a program, let's make that work. You know, let's figure out how to do that. So my medical experience was running basically this education, support, and changing people's beliefs program in an in-person group-based setting. That's how I knew to do this. And we figured, you know, if we really made a major deal out of this, over 10 years, we might be able to help maybe a million people with type 2 diabetes. Along the way, we were approached by an athlete. And his name is Sami Inkinen. And let's see, where did Rob? So on the front of this Running on Fat video, this is a video made by a documentary filmmaker named Donald O'Neill about a world champion triathlete and his wife, who was a former competitive gymnast and now marathon runner. And the two of them decided that they wanted to take a cruise, a Pacific cruise. And hear people chuckling because they started from Monterey, California, and on a 22-foot long high-tech rowboat rowed to Hawaii, about 2,800 miles, unsupported, which means they could have no resupply along the way. And they did it in 45 days and 3 hours. The previous record for two people making that crossing from California to Hawaii, the previous record was 60 days, and Sami and Meredith did it in 45 days and 3 hours. And they did it on low carb. Now, there were a couple of reasons why they chose to do a low carb, high fat fueling regimen for that endeavor. One of them was that while he was trained and competing as a world champion triathlete, amateur triathlete, Sami discovered he's pre-diabetic. This is in his early 30s. And he decided that the proximate cause of his pre-diabetes was the fact that as a competitive endurance athlete, he had been encouraged and guided to eat a diet that consisted of 10 to 15% fat, 20% protein, and close to 70% of his energy is carbohydrates. And most of that was coming from oatmeal and gels and sugar-sweetened beverages, and his phenomenally athletic, highly trained body was struggling breaking under the strain of all that carbohydrate. He's an intelligent guy, and he figured maybe I'd gotten some bad advice doing that. And he thought, he read, he looked at the literature, he came upon Jeff's and my couple books. We wrote one also on low-carb performance. And I got this email out of the blue from a guy who said, you don't know me, but I need your help. I'm gonna row a boat from California to Hawaii. I said, this guy's crazy. I'm gonna do it with my wife. And I said, I don't go near these people. But I also was convinced, based on his athletic histories, that this was not a flight of fancy for them. So I decided to have a polite meeting with them and quietly turn them off to this idea. Because my instincts were, as an internist, we internists are quite conservative, is that if anything went wrong in the thing, I'd get blamed. And his point to me over lunch, with he and Meredith and I had a lunch that was supposed to last for 45 minutes, he made the point that if I didn't give him the advice he needed, and they did it anyway, and it went wrong, he'd blame me. he's quite a convincing guy. So we worked out, because everything, they had no refrigeration on this boat. Everything had to be shelf-stable at room temperature. They had to be able to pack food. They didn't know how fast they're going to make the crossing. And the previous fastest record was 60 days, so they packed out over 60 days' worth of food. that was 70% fat, 20% protein, and 10% carbs. There was a minor problem that Meredith, up in close to that time, had been a raw foods vegan, which made the challenge a little greater. She did condescend that she would eat fish, but she wouldn't eat dairy. And we worked out the composition of this diet, and they packed the whole thing up and set off. And Sami was using mostly, for his primary protein sources were nuts, cheese, and high-fat freeze-dried hamburger. Meredith had two sources of dried fish, olives and nuts, and anyway, long story short, the major common part of their diet was a large pot of cooked vegetables once a day. They did have a small stove aboard this boat, and they would cook one hot meal a day, and they'd cook this mixed medley of cooked vegetables, pouring quite a bit of olive oil, because we had to figure out how do you get it up to 70% fat. And then they would divide up this, and then she'd put in her fish to cook it in the hot vegetables, and he put in his hamburger, and they'd eat their meals. And they had some dark chocolate with them, too. That's right. Anyway, so they set off, and they had a satellite phone on this high-tech boat, and they were posting blog posts. And about the third week into this endeavor, Sami made a little comment in his blog post. It seems we have a mouse aboard the boat because something's eating my cheese. And this perceived need for fat and protein kind of got the better of Meredith, and she did consume some of Sami's cheese. And they had a few electrolyte mineral issues partway through. We'd actually anticipated those might occur because when you're rowing, they were literally rowing, each of them, for 16 to 18 hours a day. About 10 of that overlapped. So one person was rowing. Much of the time there was one person rowing. There was 10 hours a day when the two were rowing together. But since they only had a very small covered area, enclosed area in the boat, it would hold two people in embrace, but you couldn't really sleep comfortably with two people. So they actually were kind of rowing these overlapping shifts. But when you're rowing that much, particularly as you get into the warmer ocean and you have increasing sweat losses, you know, how do you manage the mineral losses from sweat? Because sweat contains not just sodium, but potassium and magnesium. And just, you know, for whatever reason, we'd managed to kind of plot out options in advance. But the further they got into the row, the stronger they got. Now, there were 13 boats that started out in this endeavor. This was a race. Of those 13 boats, only six of them made it to Hawaii. There was one other two-person boat. Most of the boats were four-person boats. There was one other two-person boat, and it took them 70 days to make the crossing. And the further that two-person boat got, the weaker they got, because they were overtraining, they were overextending themselves. They were in what, you know, sports physiologists call staleness. Sami and Meredith got stronger. And that's a fascinating puzzle, and we won't get into details. So where is this going? Well, after they completed this endeavor, Sami, who is trained in Finland as a nuclear engineer and worked for 2 years after he graduated with his master's qualifications in nuclear engineering, he worked for a Finnish nuclear power plant for 2 years, and he said, you know, I got bored. Nothing exciting happened. Which most people would think it would be a good thing, but Sami figured he'd branch out and try something else. He'd been trying to start a software company, and that didn't work out. He didn't know how to manage a business, so he figured, and being an engineer, I should go study business. So he came to California, to Stanford, and to do an MBA. Found it very difficult to find economical lodging in Silicon Valley, not a big surprise. And so he and his roommate wrote a little program to search for rental space in the Silicon Valley area. And that little program that they wrote one weekend became the second largest real estate search firm in the United States. Sami was very successful in doing that. And you know, he could afford to do anything wanted to do in his life. After this row, he said to Jeff and me, you guys, you know, you're doing this group-based thing. That's cool. You know, in 10 years, you might help a million people with type 2 diabetes. In that same 10-year period, the world's going to create over 100 million new diabetics. You'll win the battle, you're going to lose the war. Said, we need to put this into a virtual mode on the internet. We need to be able to practice virtual medicine and scale it and push it out to 100 million people. And it's that vision that gets me here today. So I am chief medical officer of a company called Virta Health. Virta's not, Sami didn't pick this, one of our non-Finnish employees went through a Finnish dictionary and found this word that means power and flow. And so that's the meaning of the name in Finnish. And so I have a proprietary interest in this. So this is the last time in this discussion I'll mention Virta Health. You know, we're a venture-funded startup. We've been in what we call stealth mode up through pretty much the current time. So hopefully you haven't heard of us, and maybe you'll hear of us 6 months or 9 months from now, because we are actually, as a company, using venture funds, funding the what we think is the largest non-surgical diabetes reversal program ever attempted, with over with almost 500 participants, to demonstrate that we're not just thinking that this might work. We want to demonstrate that it actually does work, and publish that in the peer-reviewed literature, which makes us a little different than most fad diets. And by the way, we're not a diet. We're not a lifestyle program. We're a comprehensive intervention to help people understand the science, change their beliefs, and then turn those beliefs into positive long-term behavioral change. So I'll stop preaching there. So a core component of my research over, goes back to my first project started in 1975. So I guess that's getting over 40 years. First publication was 1980, at which time I coined the term nutritional ketosis. And the reason I had to coin that term is I, as a physician, taught at what was considered a pretty good medical school. The only thing I'd been taught about ketones is that they're toxic byproducts of fat metabolism. And I, as a physician, if I see them, should stomp them out wherever I see them by giving people more insulin or giving them more carbs or whatever. So physicians and most healthcare providers are taught that just the negative aspect of this, and that stems from what's called diabetic ketoacidosis, which occurs in what we used to call juvenile onset or type 1 diabetes, which are typically young people who, through an autoimmune disease, destroy their pancreas' ability to produce insulin. They don't have enough insulin. The body has uncontrolled regulation of fuel metabolism that leads to very high levels of ketones, which are toxic and are life-threatening. And I'll get into the details of the difference on a subsequent slide. And so I'd spent much of my career working and around defining the role of a moderate level of ketones in terms of human fuel metabolism, central nervous system function. And we were thinking of this as brain fuel, and we'll come on back to that in a bit. But what's the dramatic things that happened in the last 5 years is we have come to understand, and it wasn't me doing this research, it was people who, as we say in kind of the academic combative language, these are people who did not have a dog in the nutrition fight. These are people who are interested in what regulates the 30 to 40,000 genes that we humans have that do things in the body, because all of them aren't working all the time. Most of the time, most of our genes are asleep, not functioning. And you only want them to be turned on when you want them turned on. And if you want them turned off, they need to be turned off. What switches on and off genes? And I'll come back to this. It turns out that beta-hydroxybutyrate is a very potent and selective gene signaling device. And that fits into the field that's recently evolved called epigenetics, is what regulates the activity of the genes that we have. You inherit genes, but you don't necessarily have all those genes working. What turns them on and off? And so that's led us to this concept of that beta-hydroxybutyrate, which for all of its lifetime, and even current textbook, is an ugly duckling, probably is a soaring eagle. Let me show a couple slides, and then we can maybe see if there are questions around this. So for about 8 years during my medical training, I lived in the state of Vermont in the northeastern United States. And I lived out in the country, and I cut wood, and I heated my house with wood. And I learned that if I had a pile of logs in the front yard, that wasn't very useful, because none of them would fit in my wood stove. That the only way I could get adequate use of this firewood was to cut and split it and stack it up and keep it dry. And that was readily available fuel I could stick in my stove and keep me warm. Because as they say in Vermont, the weather there is 11 months of winter and 1 month of poor sledding. That is quite true. There was only one, in 8 years there, there was only 1 month where I never saw snow in my garden. That was July. So if you think of a long chain fatty acid like palmitic acid, which is 16 carbon saturated fat. By the way, this is in the bloodstream is one of the most toxic fats that you can find in the bloodstream. It's the higher levels of 16-0 palmitic acid you have in your blood, the greater your likelihood of developing diabetes, heart disease, stroke, and dying prematurely. So if you think that saturated fats are completely benign, it's not how much you eat, it's how much in your bloodstream. We'll come back to that one later as well. So if you take that 16 carbon saturated fat, it has to be transported as lipoproteins or bound to albumin in the blood. It can't float free by itself. You don't want it to build up in the bloodstream, because if it does, it's dangerous. But if your liver cleaves this in four places and turns it into four carbon long short chain fatty acids with a hydroxyl group attached, think of it as kind of an alcohol version of short chain fatty acid. This is beta hydroxybutyrate. This is water soluble, it diffuses across membranes, it doesn't need to be transported, and any cell in your body which has a mitochondrion in it can burn this for fuel. And it turns out to be a preferred fuel for the human brain. And it's a cleaner burning fuel than sugar. And by cleaner burning, we mean it makes less reactive oxygen species, or so-called free radicals. So in the same way that logs are not, or that the firewood is not broken up logs, beta-hydroxybutyrate is not a mistake made by the body. It appears to be a purposefully highly evolved fuel and signal that results in dramatic metabolic benefits, particularly to people who have injured metabolism to too high levels of inflammation and oxidative stress. So if I predict where this goes, this discussion goes, that's where I want to get to. Can't guarantee we'll get there, but that's what I want to do. So Jeff Volek and I, to try to emphasize this, came up with this diagram that shows the blood concentration of ketones, but this most of the what's in your blood is beta-hydroxybutyrate. That if you had orange juice and a bagel or a couple slices of toast and pancakes for breakfast, your level is going to be under 0.1. It doesn't have to be a high carbohydrate, just a moderate carbohydrate. You have almost no beta-hydroxybutyrate in your blood. If after an overnight fast, you get up, this is in the fasted state, you might be as high as 0.3, but many people stay well under 0.3 across the normal dietary phases of their life, as long as they eat a high-carb diet. And this is what the medical community, the medical establishment, thinks is normal. So if your value's under 0.3, that's a completely normal level. Anything above that is considered abnormal. But diabetic ketoacidosis doesn't even begin till you get to 10. It isn't life-threatening until you get above 15 or 20 values. So in between, if you're eating a well-formulated ketogenic diet, not in starvation, not doing fasting, but eating a diet with adequate protein, adequately restricted in carbohydrates, and most of your energy coming from fat, your values will be between 0.5 is the threshold, but 1.0 to 3.0 is we consider the optimum range for the fueling and metabolic signaling effects of beta-hydroxybutyrate. So this is 0.1, this is 1, this is 10. So you have 10 times the difference from here to here, and 10 times the difference from there to there. And so they're not, overlapping areas. These are very distinct metabolic classifications of not being in nutritional ketosis, being in nutritional ketosis, which is 1/10 the level if you have a life-threatening illness. And this is what we have to understand if you are comfortable with the idea that you could spend months or years or decades on a ketogenic diet. It's the difference between having, 2 centimeters of rain in one day, which waters your garden, and 20 centimeters of rain in a day that washes the whole garden away. They're very distinct, different levels. And then we've known from data done in the 1960s that when people are adapted to starvation, that over 2/3 of the brain's fuel supply can come from ketones, with perfectly normal brain function. That the other third coming from glucose is not required as glucose coming in the diet, because when people are totally fasting, there is no diet, the dietary glucose. That glucose is coming from what we call gluconeogenesis, that is the production of glucose from secondary products, from protein metabolism, but also from the breakdown of triglycerides, where the glycerol backbone of triglyceride can actually be used, but it's a minor component of fat storage. But it actually can be a meaningful addition to the gluconeogenesis. So this is actually glucose that has to be made by the body anyway and is being secondarily burned. This is not in any way an indication of a dietary requirement from carbohydrates. So people claim, well, the brain needs to get some of its fuel from glucose. It's false. So in the fed state, the brain can burn all, and your brain, whether no matter what you're doing with it, burns 600 calories a day. It's about one quarter of your total daily energy need just burned by just that 3-pound little squash-sized object inside your skull. All of that can come from glucose. None of it can come directly from fat, but the majority of it can come from ketones made from fat in a kind of organized, choreographed aspect of fatty acid metabolism that involves the liver converting these big hunks of fat into, you know, like palmitic acid, into beta-hydroxybutyrate, which then becomes an ideal clean burning fuel, not just for the brain, but it can be used by the heart and pretty much any other organ in the body. So how does one achieve this level of 1 to 3 millimolar beta-hydroxybutyrate? Well, you know, I am sometimes kind of vexed to read accounts of people who are on a, quote, keto diet. And they equate that with pretty much any diet with less than 30% of energy coming from carbohydrate. So low carbohydrate diets are generally regarded as being anything under 30% of dietary energy coming from carbs. And that includes the paleo diet, which if you, and again, there's lots of different, quote, renditions of paleo, but the academic leader in this field in the past has been Lauren Cordain, and he defined this as roughly about 30% of energy from protein and 20% of energy from fat. I'm sorry, 20% of energy from carbs, 30% from protein. And the what's left over is 50% from fat. And Jeff and I had a meaningful conversation with Lauren one day a few years ago, with Professor Cordain, I should say, and said, so why the 20% is carbs? He said, well, Steve, that's how much you need to have in carbs to feed your brain. And I said, well, you know, you can feed your brain with ketones. He said, yeah, but then you have to eat more fat. And nobody wants to eat more than 50% of their calories as fat. That would be really dangerous. So what we're dealing with, I mean, it was a well-reasoned argument, and it was one that he could market to his students. But it was based on ideology, not based on science. And that's one of the problems we have in nutrition is certainly the dietary guidelines that we in the United States promulgated for ourselves and the world in 1977 turned out to be completely wrong and is completely ideologically based. So getting away from ideology and thinking physiology, how do you get into nutritional ketosis? Well, you have to keep protein very moderate. This is not a high protein diet. It's a moderate protein diet. Because the culprit in suppressing ketones is primarily carbohydrates, you need to stay, for most people, at or under 10% of your daily energy requirement coming from carbs. The more insulin resistant you are, and insulin resistance is a hallmark of type 2 diabetes, the more insulin resistant you are, the more you need to bring carbohydrates down. So when we deal with people with established type 2 diabetes on medications, including insulin, we have to get people down in the 3 to 5% energy intake range from carbs, initially to trigger this metabolic change. And as we get people into nutritional ketosis, there's a varying rate at which this healing process occurs. And people over time evolve many times, oftentimes greater carbohydrate tolerance. So we start out at a very carbohydrate intolerant level, and then on an individualized basis, as people heal, we can oftentimes coach them back up to higher levels of carbohydrate intake, which gives them a broader range of foods to eat. Not because the carbohydrate is necessary, it just makes it easier to go to a restaurant or a friend's house or deal with an in-law who expects you to eat what's served. And it gives you more behavioral and social flexibility. And so this really has to be an evolving process and individualized if it's going to be highly successful. So why don't I stop at that point and see if I've offended anybody's knowledge or sensitivities too much and see if there are any questions people have before I move on to my next slide. Yes? Do we want to use a mic or?
I'll speak loudly if you like.
Okay, do that. Ideally.
Going back to that graph you had with, as you're going to ketosis, is it normal that your blood sugar level, glucose level, would drop as your ketone levels go up? And if so, what is it would be a safe level that they could drop to?
So safety of low glucose levels during ketosis and whether that normally occurs. In my metabolic ward experiments, where we actually lock people up in a diet prison and have complete control over what they eat, so we know exactly what goes in and what happens. Blood sugars, if they're elevated to start with, come down to the normal range and stay in the normal range. If they start in the normal range, and I've done studies with athletes who are very insulin sensitive and have no problems with glucose control, they stay in the normal range. We rarely see glucose go outside the normal range, unless people are doing extremes of exercise early in the adaptation process before the body is fully acclimated to using ketones and increased oxidation of fat for fuel, or if they're on hypoglycemic medications for diabetes. So we don't see values under in, you know, we in the United States are uniquely abstruse and still using milligrams per deciliter, but we don't see values under 3.5 millimolar. Well, sometimes we see values slightly above 5.5 millimolar for people who are fully keto adapted. And we are not quite sure why some people tend to flirt with the upper range of normal when they're, but yeah, we don't see wide excursions. In a really, let's say, ethically questionable pair of experiments that were done back in the late 1960s, some physicians who were dealing with patients who were adapted to total starvation for a month did an experiment. Now, these are people who had ketone levels between 5 and 7 millimolars, so starvation ketosis. They plugged an intravenous line in and slowly infused insulin into them to drive their blood sugar down to levels that should cause coma or death in people who had levels of ketones in the 5 to 7 millimolar range. And as we say, kind of sarcastically, the only people in the room who had palpations and sweating and anxiety were the physicians. The people who had the blood sugar levels that should be associated with coma or death were completely unfazed, had completely normal mentation, and there was no evidence of any perception of threat by their body's counter-regulatory system. Which means, and by the way, that could never be done when, you know, in the era of modern medical ethics. But the result is that it is clear that the human brain is perfectly happy with beta-hydroxybutyrate as not just its majority fuel, but essentially its sole fuel. So I share that because it was done, not because I endorse the ethics of that having been done.
A personal state, it's like fasted last week. I went down to 3.5, then down to 2.5. Mm-hmm.
Well, that shows what everybody knows.
Yeah, so I'm here.
So if you couldn't hear in the back, he dropped his glucose down to 2.5 millimolar while on a fairly extended period of fasting.
It's only 3 days, yeah.
Okay, but with ketones in the therapy or in the nutritional ketosis range, you had no symptoms.
No.
Okay, were you supplementing with sodium at the time?
I had bone broth, yeah.
Okay. Okay, with enough sodium in it? Because I've seen recipes for bone, we'll get into that later.
Okay.
But so these are important nuances because the higher your ketones are, the faster your kidneys excrete salt. That one of, if you think about this from a slightly different perspective of eating lots of carbohydrate, if you think from, well, if I add in carbohydrate, what does it do to my body? One of the things that carbohydrate does by making your ketones go down is it suppresses salt excretion by your kidneys, which means you retain sodium. And so when you take carbs out of your diet, you accelerate renal sodium excretion. If you don't compensate with enough salt coming in, most of the early and oftentimes some ongoing side effects that people have is they don't have enough salt in their diet. And I've got a slide on that one that I think will horrify you. So we'll come to that later. Yes, question.
How do you work out what is moderate for yourself?
The question is, in that range, what's moderate for each? Some people that we work with are so insulin resistant that they rarely get above 1.0.
So it should be lower than
And some people who are not insulin resistant or become insulin sensitive over time will go up in the 3 to 4 range. So we don't think there's a perfect number that everybody should shoot for. It's what you can get to with reasonable management of your diet. If you want to get so up in a higher range that you cut way back in protein, you will lose lean body mass as a result. We don't want to compromise strength and function just to technically get to a higher level of ketones than others. Now, in our 2/3 of our company, I always said I wasn't going to mention the company. This unnamed group of people, 2/3 of them are programmers and design people who are building the app to provide this intervention that we've put together in a virtual mode. And they're mostly young men and women. And all of them, when they join the company, want to try out this amazing new technology we have. So most of them are on a ketogenic diet. And these people compete with each other. Every morning they're in there clicking their meters and holding up the meter saying, I'm a 3.2. And someone says, yeah, I'm 3.7. And we don't encourage that kind of adolescent behavior. And by the way, since I'm probably twice the age of most people in the company, I get to be the kind of the fatherly figure who says, settle down. We don't push this out to our participants. You can play this game here in the office, but our participants are told if you're 0.5, you're good. If you're 1.0, that's probably better. Anything higher than that is just your personal biochemical signature and is not a sign of superior metabolic or physiological well-being. Let's question here and then over there.
Insulin resistance you keep talking about, is that measurable, number one? And the other thing is that have any relationship between how fast you could, how your body changes in losing weight?
So if you couldn't hear it, its question is, insulin resistance, does it affect your rate of weight loss? And the first part was,
and is it measurable?
Is it measurable? Yeah. The classic way of measuring insulin resistance is to plug an intravenous line into one arm and infuse insulin, and then that should make your body take up sugar really quickly from the bloodstream. So then you put an IV in the other arm and you run in glucose to keep blood sugar normal. The more you have to run in, the more insulin sensitive you are. That's called the hyperinsulinemic euglycemic clamp. By the way, it took me about 3 weeks to learn to say that. And it's a very difficult test to do, and we don't use that as a standard test. The easiest way to do it is you draw a blood sample and look at the insulin, typically a fasting sample, and look at the insulin level in the blood and the glucose level in the blood, and you look at the ratio of those, and that comes up with what's called an insulin-resistant score. And that's a reasonably dependable variable. But the other way we look at it is when we look at somebody's blood test and physical exam. If they have what we call metabolic syndrome, which is central weight carried centrally, high blood pressure, low good cholesterol, HDL cholesterol, high triglycerides, or a borderline high blood sugar, not in the diabetic range, but in the borderline range, any three of those five parameters classifies you as metabolic syndrome, and that means you're insulin resistant. If you're diagnosed as type 2 diabetic, you are severely insulin resistant. So, for most of cases, we don't need to do any fancy test. It's just based on the person's physical exam and basic lab tests that we can diagnose that. And the more insulin resistant it is, a population is, when you intervene for weight loss, the more insulin resistant people always lose more, find it more difficult to lose. But if you can, by putting somebody on a reduced carbohydrate intake, and we get their carbohydrate intakes down below their personal threshold of tolerance, we see dramatic improvements in insulin resistance. And the reason why we think, and I may or may not get to showing you some of the data in our current study, the reason why we seem to be quite a bit more capable of achieving across the spectrum of people significant weight losses is because we basically individualize carbohydrate levels to get people into insulin sensitivity, which then enables weight loss. So it's not the low carbohydrate, it's the improved insulin sensitivity that then gives the body permission to store what it has, or to burn what it has in storage, rather than being dependent on what's coming in from the outside. There's a question there, and then to you, sir.
Thanks, Stephen. I just want to ask,
could you stand up and talk a little louder so everybody hears?
Better,
Like, do you have to aim for higher levels, or does it just, is it just enough to be in nutritional ketosis, and it doesn't have to be that the more, the higher you are, the more weight you'll lose? If you could comment on that, please.
So there is a misconception, two misconceptions. One is the higher your ketones are, the better it is for you, and the faster you lose weight. And there's a more basic misconception, and that is that if you're in nutritional ketosis, you are necessarily losing weight. And that's patently false, because if you look at cultures where people were either pretty much pure hunters or pure herders, and we think of the Inuit in the Arctic or the Maasai in the Great Rift Valley in East Africa. These are cultures that lived for thousands of years with very little, if any, dietary carbohydrates. And they reached adulthood. They lived long enough to procreate and carry on their race and cultures. And they didn't waste away, and they were in consistent nutritional ketosis. So it is possible to be in nutritional ketosis and weight stable, where the calories from fat, mostly come from fat coming in, equal the calories burned. So I did a study in bike racers, lean guys who had almost no body fat to burn. We locked them up in a metabolic ward for 4 weeks, which is pretty expensive to do. I would have loved to have done months, but they would have gotten cabin fever in there, and B, we would have gone broke. But in 4 weeks, eating as many calories in as they burned, they stayed perfectly weight stable in terms of lean body mass and body fat content over the course of that 4 week period of time. And I don't like to point to myself, but 13 years ago, I decided to put my mouth where my mouth is and actually follow my own advice. And for 12 and a half years, I've been weight stable within roughly 2 kilos, plus or minus. And my ketones typically vary anywhere from between 0.5, 0.7 at my lowest points and then 3.0 or more after endurance exercise. So I've been in continuous nutritional ketosis, and I haven't wasted away because my dietary fat intake is such that I, and protein in moderation, that I maintain stable weight. So I don't think that the ketone level either mandates or assists weight loss. It's the insulin sensitivity that one gets by the metabolic healing association with getting away from that toxic level of carbohydrates that the body can't handle that then facilitates weight loss. But people then find their new metastable state associated with adequate fat intake. And we'll come back to the fact that in order to achieve that, after you've lost quite a bit of weight, you don't add back more carbs to stop your weight loss. You add back fat to maintain satiety, to achieve stable weight. Sir, there.
I'm a general practitioner in Essendon. I appreciate your comments about insulin resistance. It appears in practice, in medical practice, that seems to be the centerpiece of what you're talking about. And by way of what you mentioned about metabolic syndrome being a further extension of that insulin resistance, diabetes being a further down spectrum, just as an antidote, we do know from Australian statistics, 30% of our patients above 25 years old are in the metabolic syndrome, and in about 8% of the population above 25 are type 2 diabetics. Mm-hmm. So I think I did want to make a comment that in a general practice setting, to aggressively work out insulin resistance is important. And secondly, that most of us, as human beings, happen to be insulin resistant rather than insulin sensitive. Can you make a comment on that kind of distribution of human beings, metabolism, insulin resistance, insulin sensitivity?
Sure. So the distribution of insulin resistance across populations actually varies geographically, and probably based on genetic differences in different populations. So we're a bit worse off than you in Australia. We're about 9 to 10% of people who have type 2 diabetes, and 35 to 40% of our population is pre-diabetes. So we're actually above the half our population in the United States has conditions closely associated with insulin resistance. And there is no drug that makes insulin resistance better. You can enhance insulin sensitivity. There are some insulin sensitizing drugs But usually the side effects overwhelm the benefits. So really the only tool we have is what we're talking about today. In some areas among Asian Pacific Islanders, the prevalence of type 2 diabetes and insulin resistance approaches 75%. And that's also true in the Gulf states, the United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, and we think that these are probably genetically mediated traits. I've worked closely with a pioneering physician in Canada, Dr. James Wortman, who is himself mixed race First Nations, and among the First Nations people in Canada, the 2.5 million First Nations people in Canada, they have 3 to 5 times the prevalence of type 2 diabetes of European origin Canadians, living in the same towns and now sourcing their food from pretty much the same places. So it appears to be significant racial genetic aspects of this as well. And we haven't figured out what specifically those genes are. But we, in every population we've brought this technology to, the response is to carb, there's a positive response to getting carbs down under each individual's personal level of carbohydrate tolerance.
Yeah. Could you make a couple of comments about metformin? I've diagnosed myself with diabetes 16 years ago and sort of managed it until earlier this year with exercise and low GI, and now I've seen the light and I'm low carb and I've dropped another sort of 15 kilos or so, and my HbA1c is 4.8, but you know, here I'm rather attached to being on my metformin since I've been on it for 16 years. Mm-hmm. And it does seem to make it quite easy to go into ketosis from what I've measured. Do you like it? Do you hate it?
So the question is metformin and its role in healthcare. Since metformin has now been demonstrated in animal models to increase longevity, it's not just a diabetes pharmaceutical, it's a longevity pharmaceutical. And so I would say it's it's the least undesirable drug. I'm a fully trained allopathic physician. I was trained to write scripts.
Yeah, me too.
And as long as a person doesn't have GI side effects of metformin, I strongly encourage people who are taking it to keep taking it. And if people have marginal control and their A1Cs are 5.8 or 5.9, and that's the best they do on carb restriction, we're not adverse to adding metformin to get them under that 5.7 magic threshold. Because all the data is, the lower your A1C is, preferably by natural means, the greater the health benefit, including, we haven't done the human experiment because it'll take 120 years, but including potentially longevity. If I get to it, I'll show you some slides from non-human longevity studies that are, again, for people who don't have a dog in the nutrition fight, these are people who are interested in the regulation of inflammation, oxidative stress, and aging. It's turning out that nutritional ketosis is a very potent tool. But here and then to the gentleman there.
Could you please comment on polycystic ovarian syndrome, insulin resistance, and the role of low-carb, high-fat diets?
Okay, I'm not OBGYN, I'm not trained in OBGYN,
yeah.
But the question was polycystic ovary syndrome and insulin resistance. There's an extremely strong correlation between the diagnosis of PCOS and very severe insulin resistance. Oftentimes in people who don't have the physical, you know, the obesity and central obesity and other manifestations. There is a remarkable lack of research in this area, in part because PCOS is often associated with infertility, and fertility specialists, can't make money prescribing a low-carb diet. I don't want to pass that out there. But more importantly, the medical legal aspects of putting somebody on a ketogenic diet, if she becomes pregnant on a ketogenic diet and there's a birth defect, it won't be blamed on anything other than the diet. And, you know, in the United States, I live in an extremely litigious environment where any poor outcome in medicine is likely to result in suit. And that deters research in this area. That said, there is a physician in the United States who works for the Veterans Administration named Dr. Will Yancey, who has done research along with Eric Westman at Duke University. And Will Yancey did a small study of women veterans diagnosed with PCOS. And he found it difficult to get them to stay on it, but of four women he got to stay on this diet for 6 months, two of them achieved pregnancy within a 6 month period of time, which is essentially unheard of for that syndrome. Yeah. It's very promising, but it's, you know, politically and medical legally, it's a tough place to go. But I also know a number of physicians and or their spouses who have achieved pregnancy and carried healthy babies to normal birth in full nutritional ketosis. And my colleague and friend in British Columbia, Dr. James Wortman, his wife kind of unknowingly conceived because she didn't have regular periods and didn't discover that she was pregnant until 3 months into a normal pregnancy. And Jay loves to post videos on YouTube about his daughter Isabel. Jay is an invertebrate skier. He joined us in Vail last year and probably outskied pretty much almost everybody there. Is that true, Ryan? Yeah. Jay is in his early 60s, is not faint of heart in terms of speed. And his 6-year-old daughter Isabel, when we skied with her last year on their home turf at Whistler, destroyed me. Because she can do 800 meters of vertical descent nonstop on black diamond slopes at 40 times points, or divided by 0.6, is 60 plus kilometers per hour. She's been skiing since she was 16 months old. And she has her whole life been from conception has been a low carb baby. Not that that one case proves a possibility. And there are other physicians as well I won't point out. Jay is in the open about his remarkable daughter. We're all proud of our progeny, but Jay in particular is pretty effusive. The gentleman here.
I was wondering where intermittent fasting fits into your scheme.
Maybe we can reserve that, okay. Because that could, you might not want to press that button because I do have some concerns about intermittent fasting. And my views are not completely negative, but they're not completely positive. And being a science-based, trying to be reasonably rigorous in science-based, we have to talk about where the science is rather than where the ideology is. And I do want to talk about that, but let's wait an hour. In the very back, and then here, and then we'll move on, okay?
Thank you. I was wondering whether you can comment on whether a low-carb diet, if there's any evidence that shows it has benefits for fibromyalgia or syndrome like chronic fatigue.
So the question was a low-carb diet and fibromyalgia. And again, the pathophysiology of fibromyalgia remains, to my reading, I haven't looked up on it in the last week, but it's reasonably obscure. But it appears to be associated with a significant degree of inflammation, some underlying inflammation. And I'll show you some data on the effect of a well-formulated ketogenic diet on a host of inflammation biomarkers in humans. And it appears to be uniformly positive in terms of if you get this diet lifestyle down, it really puts a damper on inflammation. And we have a number of case reports of people who had severe fibromyalgia where nothing else worked, this appeared to be a reasonably effective route back to normalcy. But I can't tell you what percentage of people who go on this type of regimen will have relief and which won't, because it's not been prospectively studied to my knowledge. So I apologize if I can't give you a positive answer, but I try to be honest in what I don't know. So the question is, if you've been consistently in nutritional ketosis, not eating sugar at all, and then you either inadvertently or just by some moment of weakness, maybe two glasses of wine, you hit the dessert cart and you have a lapse. Two things is for people who are in nutritional ketosis continuously, you ask, do they forget? Well, the pancreas isn't poised to respond to a burst of sugar. And so you'll have an accentuated response the first time around. because you lack that first phase response that's conditioned by repeatedly challenging your body with doses of carbs. But within a day or two, most people's response comes back to reasonably to normal. So there's only the first hit is accentuated. But we don't encourage people to keep taking it just to kind of, because you will go back to where you were before in terms of insulin, glucose intolerance and insulin resistance over time. So for many people, this is, you don't do this for a year and then you can go back to eating anything and everything and you're completely, you know, back to where you were when you were 18 years old. No, it doesn't happen. But there is nothing overtly toxic about a lapse. Most of people we work with realize this is, and come to understand, it's not just a sense of guilt that makes them feel bad. They physically don't feel as well when you reverse the benefits of the sustained nutritional ketosis. So our experience with people, particularly who have had problems with weight, metabolic syndrome, and type 2 diabetes, is that understanding the link between consistency with the carb restriction within their level of personal tolerance and the ongoing sense of well-being, that this becomes what people call a virtuous cycle. And so it really, over time, people learn through the learning process, it becomes self-reinforcing. So unlike most diets, where the longer you're on a diet, you know, restricting calories and trying to see the scale go down, month after month, it gets harder and harder. Our participants tell us, we don't wheedle them or twist their arms to tell us this. Most of our participants tell us, the longer I'm on this, the easier it gets. And so it really becomes self-reinforcing. We have had people who've been consistently adherent to carb restriction for years, and then some unanticipated major life event kicks them out of this. And very commonly, they'll come back to it with an even greater appreciation and renewed commitment because of the consumer perceived benefit. It's not us telling you, you know, take this medicine, make your cholesterol go down. You don't feel anything, but it's good for you. In this case, people realize the benefit. And if they get it right, and if we can coach them in getting it right, it really becomes a positive self-reinforcing process. That doesn't take incredible character and will. It just takes, you know, comfort in what they're doing and knowledge that it's not doing them harm.